Welcome to my presentation. My name is Christian Ebelø, and I will present our paper, Culture in Collaborative Linked Data Networks. So I want to start off by asking the question, who is the president of the United States? Most people would probably answer Joe Biden. However, if we ask DBPJ and Jargo, some of the largest open knowledge graphs out there, he's actually not listed as the president, but only the vice president and presumptive Democratic nominee, whereas his predecessor, Donald Trump, is listed as the current president. Now, this data is obviously false. More specifically, it's outdated. And what happens is that the web of data today relies solely on the data providers to not only maintain access to the data, but also to keep data up to date and factual. This is a big burden on the data providers and often results in unavailable, outdated, or even false data that the user can't do anything about. So if we want to let users do something about these issues, and relieve some of these burdens from the data providers, we have to talk about two things. There's the data availability and data updatability. So as for the data availability, this has been researched previously. For instance, Picnic let users join as nodes in a peer-to-peer network and replicate some of the data, meaning that even if the uploader fails, we still have access to the data. As for updatability, well, if we let users propose updates to a knowledge graph and ensure that they have to reach a consensus on the updates, this means that users could actually collaborate on keeping the data up to date and thus alleviating this burden as well from the data providers. Furthermore, if we store the updates as a chain of updates, we can actually enable version control and roll back updates to a previous or fragments to a previous state in case of false data. We could even process queries dynamically over previous versions if we, for instance, wanted to have consistent query answers over scientific studies that were obtained using previous versions of a dataset. So to this end, we propose Culture in Collaborative Knowledge Chains, which first and foremost is a peer-to-peer system. Now, Culture in is divided into several smaller communities. Our community and the idea behind a community is just that we have a bunch of nodes that collaborate on keeping some data set up to date. So any node can upload a data fragment to a community, and any node in the community can propose an update to this fragment, and then on consensus we could actually apply the update. So if we zoom in on one of the nodes, we see that the node actually stores the data fragments that are within the community, as well as the update chain associated with this fragment. Furthermore, we allow users to not only participate in communities, but also to observe a community. Observers only index the data, don't actually store it themselves, so this is to ensure that we can process queries over data that we don't store ourselves, so we don't have to store all the data. And thus, the nodes rely on asking a participant in a community. Furthermore, nodes contain some metadata about, for instance, fragment ownership and so on. So consider the same network as before with the following data fragments. Obviously, one of the data fragments is outdated, and let's say that node N3 wants to update this fragment to reflect current reality. So the first step in doing this is that it has to propose a transaction. Now, a transaction is a set of operations that then consist of an RDF triple and a description of whether or not this triple is to be added to the dataset or removed from the dataset. Besides an operation, a transaction also contains some provenance information, for instance, a signature from the author, which is then used to see whether or not the author is also the original uploader of the fragment, but I'll get back to that, and then a timestamp. So in this case, in this example, node 3 would propose a transaction that adds Joe Biden type president to the fragment and removes Donald Trump type president from the fragment. And applying this would end up with the fragment that contains Joe Biden and Vladimir Putin as presidents. So after proposing a transaction, the node 3 has to obtain a consensus, community-wide consensus on the transaction. So it sends the transaction to the other participants in the network, in the community, in this case, node 4 and node 5. These nodes then have to consider whether or not they want to accept the transaction. So nodes will accept the transaction if the author is either the original uploader of the transaction or if the user actually goes in and presses the accept button actively. In this example, we see that a majority of the nodes want to accept the transaction, and thus all the participants apply the transaction on their local data store. So by that I mean updating the fragment itself, but also pushing the transaction to the end of the chain. After that is done, the participants will propagate the update to the observers, and all both observers and participants will then update the index that is associated with this fragment. So after a transaction has achieved a consensus, as I mentioned in the slide earlier, we need to apply the transaction on the all participants. The way this is done is we update the fragment itself and we push the transaction to the end of the chain. So again, we update the fragment, insert Joe Biden, remove Donald Trump, and we add the new fragment as the head of the chain. So the chain is structured in a way that the current head of the chain is the latest applied transaction. So the transaction, besides having the information about the operations and the provenance information, as can be seen on the slide, it has a header that just points to the previous transaction. And this allows us to roll back, to go from the latest and roll back to a previous state more efficiently. So let's go through how a process can be queried using Colchain. So the first step is to match triple patterns to fragments using a distributed index. Now, a distributed index is just a mapping from a triple pattern to a fragment that's relevant for the triple pattern, and then a mapping from the fragment to a node that stores the fragment. Now, this allows us to not have to flood the entire network with requests, but actually be more selective in which nodes we have to ask during query processing. Then we determine a join order. This can be done even through either using variable counting or maybe even using the cardinality estimations of the triple patterns. Then we process each triple pattern, and at each step we use the bindings from previously evaluated triple patterns to limit the amount of intermediate bindings we have to transfer. So for each triple pattern, if the query includes a timestamp, we materialize the fragment to the earlier version. So we have to roll back the fragment and materialize the earlier version, and then process the triple pattern over that fragment. Otherwise, we just process the triple pattern over the currently available fragment. And then we compute the final result by combining the intermediate results of the joining triple patterns. So let's go through an example of how we can materialize an old version using Colchain. So essentially what we do is we go from the head of the chain and we just go back until we get to the corresponding timestamp, and along the way at each step keep track of the changes. So in this case we will keep track of the fact that in this transaction we added Joe Biden, removed Donald Trump. The previous transaction we added Donald Trump and removed Barack Obama, so we keep track of those changes. Now we reach the timestamp that we requested, and so we have to reverse the operation. So we have to remove remove Joe Biden and add Barack Obama. And we end up with the fragment, the materialized fragment that contains Barack Obama and Vladimir Putin as presidents. So let's go through an example of how to process a query in Colchain. So we have the same network structure and the updated data set from before as well. And then we have a query that finds United States presidents and their party. So the first step is to map triple patterns to fragments using the index. In this case, this is done using something called PPBF indexes, which just takes into account the joinability of the fragments that are relevant for joining triple patterns. So in this case, for instance, we leave out the orange fragment because it doesn't produce any join result with the blue fragment, and so on. Then we determine the join order. In this case, it would be this join order. And then we just go through the triple patterns at each step using the previously evaluated triple patterns. So for TP1, the fragment isn't available locally on node 1, so we have to send a request, in this case to node 5, and get the results back to Joe Biden and Vladimir Putin. We move on to the next triple pattern. We send this, in this case, to node 2. It's not available locally either. Along with the bindings for TP1, we get the results Joe Biden back. And then for the third triple pattern, in this case it's not available locally, we send it to node 5, along with the bindings from TP1 joined with TP2, so as a result we get Joe Biden from the Democratic Party. which also is the output result of the entire query. So to test our approach, we implemented it in Java. We ran 128 concurrent nodes on a server with 128 CPU cores and 2 TB of RAM, where the resources were split evenly across all the nodes. We used large RDF bins, which comprises 13 datasets with over 1 billion triples and 40 queries in 4 different categories of varying complexity and sizes of intermediate results. So in the first experiments, we compared our approach to state of the art, more specifically Picnic, that uses a flooding, that is when it processes a triple pattern, has to flood the entire network with requests to ensure that it reaches all fragments. Then Picnic with the same indexes as Coltrane use, that limits the amount of requests that has to be made. What we found was that Coltrane has comparable performance to Picnic with the indexes and thus much faster than Picnic with flooding, which is expected since we use a similar query processor. Actually improving on query processing performance was out of scope of the paper. Then we assessed the impact of the sizes of the communities on query processing, and what we found was that larger communities generally are faster, and this is due to the fact that with larger communities there's a higher chance that fragments are available locally, so we have to send less requests. We also included a Cepheid distribution of the community sizes, which just means we have a lot of very popular communities and a long tail of very unpopular communities. The performance of this distribution was that it was similar to the smaller communities, because with the long tail of unpopular communities, there's a good chance that you actually have to query another node for the data, so you end up with more requests. Then we wanted to assess the ability to roll back an update over chains of various lengths and actually process a query over this previous version. So what we actually found was that the approach to materialize the earlier version is actually quite scalable. The largest part of the overhead, up to 94% of this overhead of materializing the earlier version, is actually spent on decompressing the current file and compressing the new materialized version, or the earlier version, which is mainly due to the RDF encoding technique that we use. The story is the same with when we apply new updates. Our approach to validation is actually quite scalable, even when the community size increases, and it's actually way more scalable than the materialization due to the decompression and compression of the new version again. So the largest part of this overhead is also due to the specific RDF encoding that we actually use. So in summary, we proposed Coltrane collaborative knowledge chains, which is a system that lets users provide updates to knowledge graphs, that let users replicate data fragments and process queries over previous versions of the data sets, which not only alleviates this burden of the data providers, but actually also ensures that it's possible to achieve consistent answers for scientific studies that were obtained using previous versions of data sets. We showed that the update of providing updates and rolling back a data set to a previous version is actually caused primarily by the materialization of the new or earlier version of the fragment itself, which is in particular caused by the used RDF encoding, the fact that we have to decompress and compress the file all again. So this goes to show that our approach, our algorithm to actually roll back an update, or our validation protocol, are actually quite scalable and has little impact on the overhead, which is could be improved by changing the RDF encoding. So we also showed that Coltrane has similar query processing performance and network usage statistics as state-of-the-art interfaces, and thus that Coltrane offers not only high availability and high performance, but also enables consensual updates and access to previous versions in an efficient way. So that was all for me. I want to thank you for joining, and if you have any questions, feel free to join the Q&A session or send me an email or go to our website, which is linked on the slide here. Thank you.